Hey listeners, it's your host, Dacia. You're about to hear an episode featuring conductor Mei-Ann Chen, who just conducted a program at the Texas Music Festival, which is actually still happening here on the U of H campus where Classical Classroom is recorded. So if you're here in Houston, make sure you go check out some of what's going on over there. You can find out more on their website. Mei-Ann is going to teach us all about Tchaikovsky, his creative process, which is very interesting, and his lovely little ditty that he wrote about a play by some guy named Shakespeare. I don't know. Speaking of music festivals, we're about to do our second annual summer music festival series featuring people who are currently at the Music Academy of the West, so watch out for that later in July. Hope you enjoy this episode, and if you do, make sure you go to iTunes and subscribe to us and rate us and review us, because Shakespeare would want you to? I don't know. Anyway, enjoy the episode. My name is Dacia Clay. I'm the audio librarian here at Classical 91.7. While I'm a real librarian, I have a deep, dark
secret.
I know very little about classical music. I grew up listening to rock, and I know something about jazz. But when it comes to classical, but I really want to learn. So, every week on this show, a classical music expert will give me a piece of classical music they think I should know, and then we'll discuss it. Come learn with me in the Classical Classroom. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Classical Classroom. I am Dacia Clay, and here with me today is Mei-Ann Chen. Mei-Ann is music director of the Memphis Symphony and of the Chicago Sinfonietta. She's conducted major symphonies all over the U.S. and the world, including our own Houston Symphony. She's here in Houston right now because she is going to be a guest conductor at the Texas Music Festival, which is currently taking place here on the U of H campus. Mei-Ann Chen, welcome to the Classical Classroom.
Thank you for having me.
So what are you going to be teaching me about today?
One of my favorite pieces by Tchaikovsky, the Romeo and Juliet Fantasy Overture. In fact, this is a piece that a lot of people will recognize, probably background music to some of the films out there.
Yeah.
It's a piece that the orchestra loved to play because it has great rhythm in the fighting section, has the love section, luscious melodies that the orchestra just get to sing and soar above, you know, like an eagle. And so,
yeah. Before we go into the piece, I have a few questions. One of which is, could you tell me a little bit about Tchaikovsky? We've talked about him just a bit on this show before, but like, who was he? What was he known for? Like, where did he live and when? That kind of thing.
So Tchaikovsky was considered one of the most iconic and important composers in what we call the Romantic period in music. And that's like the second half of the 19th century. So, for example, he was born in 1840. And really, this piece was written like in about 1869 when he was 29 years old. And this is about the juncture that he was about to write a couple years later, his fourth symphony, which is pretty well known. His last three symphonies, 4, 5, 6, were all written, you know, so we're talking about the third version of the Romeo and Juliet. That's the version that people know of it now.
Uh-huh.
He went through many revisions, and the final version, the third version from 1880.
Mm-hmm.
And about this time, he also wrote very well-known pieces like Capriccio Italian,
mm-hmm.
along with 1812 Overture that people probably associate with the big cannons.
Uh-huh.
On July 4th, as we celebrate the country's National Day, it's often play.
Yeah.
You know, you can hear orchestras performing this outdoor with the cannons. His last symphony was more like 1893-ish.
Uh-huh.
It's nicknamed Pathetique, really his way of coming to terms with life, with fate.
We did an episode on that piece. That was the other Tchaikovsky episode. I don't know why I'm having such a hard time seeing his name today.
Oh, no, but you know, for me, Tchaikovsky stands for one of those unique voices. You have to imagine this is a time where all the countries, mostly in Europe, was trying to find their own identity through arts.
Yeah.
And so the composers are trying to find their voice. Mm-hmm. Tchaikovsky being in Russia, what does it mean to have a Russian voice as a composer? So they were actually the big five that Tchaikovsky was not considered one of them.
Yeah.
The national big five of the Russian schools, you know, we talked about the Rimsky-Korsakov, Mussorgsky, Balakirev, who was actually Tchaikovsky's mentor.
Oh, wow.
Who actually told Tchaikovsky to write a piece on Romeo and Juliet.
Really?
So Tchaikovsky got an instruction from Balakirev and said, you should write a piece about Romeo and Juliet.
Huh.
And Tchaikovsky said, okay.
And he, and, you say so.
Right. Yeah. And he went even a step further of saying, here are the forms I think you should have. Here are the harmony structure you should have. Here's how the layout of the piece. So he was very bossy mentor. And Tchaikovsky actually took it pretty well. I mean, he was one composer that was never really confident about his own work.
Really?
He has doubts. I know. I mean, when we think about all the great pieces he wrote, I mean, yet when he wrote, I mean, the Romeo and Juliet first version from 1869, I think it wasn't received well.
Oh, yeah. I was going to ask you, so why so many versions of this piece?
Right. So he was trying to get to that final form. I mean, he wasn't alone. Like Beethoven was also famous of having a sketchbook when he walked in the woods. And so Tchaikovsky, you know, sometimes I'm not a composer, but I envy those who have music just come to their heads.
Right.
And for him, you know, if every composer is like Mozart, which literally, it's almost like a divine inspiration that came to Mozart, and he never have to erase anything. He just put it down on the paper from what he heard in his head. And so other composers are not as simple when it comes to composing their works. So Tchaikovsky really struggled with this. Well, you could say he was still a young man in the late 20s.
Yeah.
And he was also, you know, looking to find his own voice as a person. I mean, before writing this piece, he fell in love with the only woman in his life. It was a soprano that he was hoping to get married to, but she married a Spanish baritone instead. It really broke his heart. I think he sat through the entire performance of hers really in tears. And I think it wasn't a secret that Tchaikovsky was a well-known homosexual composer.
Right.
And even in that time, it was almost considered really not something the public or the government tolerated.
Right.
And so he really had a big struggle with this, as you probably learned from the Pathetique, as he was coming to terms with his own lives and fate, and how fate played a role in his last, especially the last three symphonies. But here, back to the Romeo and Juliet, the ultimate love story, and it gave him a great platform in terms of expressing. I think of Tchaikovsky, a great melodic composer.
Yeah.
You almost can hum, you know, the tune from all his great pieces.
Oh, yeah, the 1812 Overture.
Right? I mean, it's like every piece comes with a famous tune that you can hum.
It's got a hook.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And then the Romeo and Juliet. You just can't help but to fall in love with Tchaikovsky's melodies. And so here was a great platform for him to explore. But as you heard me say earlier, I mean, he had a bossy mentor. And that must be hard to, like, I want to write this piece and someone is hovering over you. And he sent, you know, the music back and forth. I mean, back then, they don't have emails or attachments. They sent by mails, like, what do you think, this section? And so I think maybe one of the reasons that he took such a long time mm-hmm. to coming to the final version, which has it complete. You know, the coda is just the funeral march, you know, at the end. It's really just to the heart. I think he finally found the right balance for the piece and finally also willing to stand up for himself.
I was going to ask, did he finally tell his mentor that he needed to bug off?
Know that he did that, but I think in some way, musically, he did. He kind of sort of stood on his own. But I think he took a lot of good advices in, which also made this piece stronger at the end.
Sure. Yeah. There's sort of a fine line between receiving, being open to and receiving constructive criticism and knowing your own artistic voice and maintaining your own artistic vision and kind of like this struggle to find that line as a creative person.
That's right.
I know it can be a struggle. So, but you think that he finally did find that place?
Yeah. And so that's why I mentioned 1880. So he is literally 40 years old at this point.
Yeah.
He's really becoming a mature composer in his own right. And I like to also quote a beautiful story, a famous cellist by the name of Pablo Casals, who was responsible for reintroducing and making it popular the Bach solo suites for cello. Mm-hmm. And I remember reading in his memoir, you know, his quotes that one day he was telling other people, one day you have to come on stage. Mm-hmm. Forget about all the stuff your teachers taught you. And so this is back to, Tchaikovsky finding his own voice because it's unmistakably Russian.
Yeah.
Like the chorale, the woodwind chorale, the beginning of the piece, it's very much almost religious in some way, like the Orthodox chanting a little bit with the woodwind chorale. It's very solemn. And yet, he didn't quote anyone's melody.
Yeah.
All the melodies were original. And yet, all the characteristic of Russian music is there.
This piece already sounds so dramatic.
It's like keeping you suspended there with the pizzicato. It's his way of building momentum, as you heard, the rhythm in this section just changed from kind of suspending, we don't know exactly where the next beat, and now you hear the pause.
Yeah.
And then it goes back to like the beginning.
These ominous strings.
with like a horn accent here and there.
Yeah.
Kind of predicting something that's going to come. There was the horn. If you listen to the woodwinds, that's what we're calling a suspension. Like they're going into a dissonant and then resolving with a consonant. Trying to slowly create more tension. I love the harp here. It's like trying to introduce some kind of pulsation with the harp. Just as you think it goes quiet, here takes the opening and make it more violent. Like the strings is welling up. You can definitely hear that here.
You hear that drum just sort of rumbling in the background.
That's right. That timpani is going to come to the fore right here. And it's like giving up after that.
Yeah.
Courage to try to gather courage to fight. It's almost like giving up, but you will see what happens.
His music is so filled with emotion. It's amazing.
Yes.
It reminds me a lot of Beethoven, actually.
You're right.
Yeah.
Yes.
Just the, like, pulling on your heartstrings.
Absolutely.
You know?
Here's the fight scene that I told you about. Right here. I love Russian music in the Romantic period because as a young musician growing up, when you play those Russian pieces, it's like your blood is boiling. It's like, wow, it's all that energy, you know, the dueling between the Montagues and the Capulets. I mean, you can totally see. I told the violin, the string section, the bows are like your swords. You know, so play
great.
It with that kind of energy.
Like West Side Story.
Absolutely. Trying to pull to each other who has the right downbeat, you know, it's like a battle already.
It's like back and forth.
Yeah, you're being pulled. Yeah. And so many notes coming up.
Yeah.
One last big crash. Cymbals.
The strings are gonna catch on fire.
That's right. Instrumentation has softened to a bassoon color, which is warm, coupled with the cello bass. And the horns in the background. You know it's going into a different section. He's prepping for that different color to come.
I feel like we're sort of in a waiting room right now.
English horn solo, right here. With viola, that very close to the human range is almost like It's introducing the male character of the story.
Yeah.
Then, higher register. Harp and strings. It's almost like the female character is now being seen in the distance, almost. Very muted string colors. And the two side joins. Blossoms into a love duet right here.
He makes you wait a really long time for that payoff, because you know that hook is coming, but
right. It's like, where?
Well, yeah, right, like, how is that going to come out of this? Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And I love how you mentioned the key word for Tchaikovsky's music, the raw emotions.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just, even though it was written so long ago, I mean, it's like a museum piece by the date of it, 1880.
Right.
But yet you feel like it's like written yesterday for you.
Yeah.
You know, it's so relevant.
Totally. It's like emotions that have been around for as long as people have.
That's right.
Yeah. Why did Tchaikovsky's mentor want for him to write this? And did Tchaikovsky himself, did he actually like Shakespeare? Was he inspired by Shakespeare?
That's a great question, because I think especially Romeo and Juliet has been in history as one of the most popular topics for composers throughout ages. So we're talking about earlier example, Berlioz has written, you know, symphonic materials for Romeo and Juliet. Later composer, also Russian, Prokofiev, actually wrote suites of Romeo and Juliet that is very popular still in the concert halls. It's one of those, it's like quintessential love stories that, you know, there's the drama of the story that you can explore, you know, like the fight scene, the love scene. I mean, it's just so much materials set up for you. I guess as a composer, if you find the right material, you know, now the fight is coming back.
Oh, the fight's coming back.
It's not all
not all fun
easy.
And games. Strings are talking to each other.
Yes. So I would say instead of the real battle scene like we heard, this is more of a struggle. Because, you know, the two lovers are from rivalry, you know, families.
Yeah.
So you have, you know, who are you loyal to?
Right.
You want to be with that person, but you really can't be with that person because that person represents the rivaling families.
Right.
So this is the struggle I think the two characters go through.
Mm-hmm.
And even though it's easy to put characters to the music, like what we're doing, I should say in the Romantic period, there are two very distinct voices, almost like rivalries as well. One championed by Johannes Brahms, who's a German composer, was a successor to Beethoven. Brahms' strong belief, very similar to Beethoven's line, was that music speaks for itself.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't need to have a story.
Right.
And even Beethoven Symphony No. 6, you can argue with me, well, the Pastoral Symphony that has five movements, has a title at the beginning of each movement to sort of give you an impression of his, you know, there's the thunderstorm movement, there is the sky clear after the storm. But Beethoven made it very clear. He doesn't want you to associate with very specific programmatic characters. Mm-hmm. He wants to write the feeling of those life experience.
Yeah.
And so contrasting to Brahms' school of pure music, not programmatic music, is...
Isn't it also called, sorry to interrupt, but it's also called absolute music?
Yes.
I recently learned
about
this from another person that was on the show. Tamara McCoy was talking about the difference between programmatic music, which sort of tells a story.
That's right.
And absolute music, which is sort of self-referential.
Perfect.
Yeah.
That's
okay.
It. That's it. And so the other camp, the famous example is Wagner, who actually created the Ring cycle of four operas that you have to sit through four nights. I mean, that he created his own world. He created his own instruments, the Wagner tuba, because he was looking for more possibilities. You know, what he had back then wasn't enough. And so he created this gigantic world of programmatic music. So, you know, it's so easy to describe characters. We're almost doing kind of a programmatic approach to Tchaikovsky's music, even though it was Tchaikovsky's sort of more in the middle. I mean, he doesn't tell you exactly this is the love scene, this is the battle scene, even though musically, as you heard it, it was very clear portray of the characters. So I just thought it's interesting to mention that as a background of what's development in the music history as Tchaikovsky was finding his own voice.
Yeah, I think that is really interesting. So it sounds kind of like you're saying that he is clearly sort of telling a story. It is sort of programmatic music, but the voices aren't completely distinct. It's not a literal reference to, like, these strings represent Juliet and these instruments represent Romeo and here are the Capulets and here's, it's not that, it's more complex. It's more layered.
Right.
And
so
it's kind of a mixture of program and absolute music.
Right.
Yeah.
And so what I was sharing earlier was more of my personal interpretation of the characters.
Everyone does. This is my favorite thing about doing the show. Is that everybody's got a story, they even if there aren't characters, you know, specifically to refer to, they make up characters in their heads.
Well, I think it helps those of us who actually make. Well, I don't actually make the sound. If you hear me as a conductor, that I will be worrisome. But as I'm working the piece with the students, I think it helps for the students to understand some of the possibilities. You know, images, a picture is worth 1,000 words, right?
Right.
So having sort of the story, I mean, the Romeo and Juliet, the nice thing is that we mentioned it has a story.
Mm-hmm.
And so when we use the story as a sort of a backdrop, it really helps them to play certain sections differently.
Right, you can kind of get into it because the human brain works on story. Like that's how we do everything. That's how our brains are organized and it's what speaks to us and gets to our emotions is the arc of the story and the characters and stuff like that. Okay, speaking of story, let's get back to the story.
Absolutely.
What are our characters doing now?
You hear that timpani like a heartbeat?
Yeah.
Da 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 da.
Oh yeah. Oh, so this is the part where they're dying. Spoiler alert.
And it referenced the beginning.
Yeah.
But in a much more peaceful way.
everything seems to be sort of resolving.
Right.
Quiet.
So I like to think that love triumphs.
Right.
You know,
yeah.
Out of the story.
Right. Over death.
Yes,
yeah.
Exactly. We have a famous Chinese love story. It's our Chinese version of the Romeo and Juliet. It's called The Butterfly Lovers.
Yes, I've heard of this.
There's actually a violin concerto written that's been very popular.
Mm-hmm.
So in that story, both lovers, one died because of ill health. The other chose to die with him, but they all become butterflies at the tomb that they were buried, and they will finally be able to be together. So here, I like to think that they're finally together in spirit.
Right. Yeah, it sounds like it. That was awesome. So you're about to perform this piece. What else are you going to be performing with it? What are you going to pair with this?
Sure. The whole program will be starting with the Tchaikovsky, and then we have a wonderful concerto winner by the name of Juan Esteban Martinez, who is going to be playing an incredible contemporary clarinet concerto by John Francais. And then we also have Britten's Young Person's Guide to the Orchestra.
Yes.
And then the very last piece is Stravinsky's second ballet out of the three ballet that really changed music history. We're doing the Petrushka 1947 version. You know, when I do Stravinsky, it's almost like, you know, everybody knows Tchaikovsky's Nutcracker. Right, there's all different characters. It's almost Stravinsky's way of his Nutcracker. But these are puppets with a little bit darker side of their love triangle, but also this despair that is reflecting human experience, which is very interesting that you make the puppets almost like humans.
Yeah.
And incredible piece for orchestra. Nice. You have to count in 5, in 7, in 8, in a measure of 3 or 1. And it's, you know, I've been teaching the students to count in Chinese because when you count to 7 in English, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, there are 2 sounds in 7, so it's not really 7. And so I've been teaching them to count and conduct in 7 and 8 in Chinese, and they're doing a fantastic job at it.
Can you count to 7 in Chinese?
So it's like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, away from the festival and having basic Chinese already mastered.
Nice.
That's like number eight.
A side benefit.
Absolutely.
Didn't know you were going.
I just say they're going to surprise their Chinese friends when they're back to where they are.
That's great. Mei-Ann, thank you so much for being on the show today.
Thank you for having me. It's
this great
fun. Great.
Yeah. All right, everybody, that does it for this episode of Classical Classroom. For more Classroom, go to houstonpublicmedia.org/classroom. Follow us on social media. There are links to all of those social mediums on our webpage. Email me at dclay@houstonpublicmedia.org. Don't forget to subscribe to us, rate us, and review us on iTunes or else. Thanks today to audio producer Todd Toddkovsky Hulslander for twiddling knobs. Thanks to editor Mark DiClaudio for his piercing star-crossed eyes. Thanks to Mei-Ann Chen for being here today. Thanks to me for saying words. But most of all, thanks to you for listening. We'll catch you next time.